my fire, the one desire. Believe when I say I want it that way. But we
Hi, Jen. Hi, I can't hear you. Can you hear me? Wait, let me try. Oh, wait, it's my fault.
Gun.
Yeah, I had my Bluetooth speakers on, so now I can hear you.
Okay.
My bad.
All good. You can keep playing music for a few more minutes, but I'll get the PowerPoint started.
Okay.
That's all right with you. Is it just through the YouTube channel?
Yeah.
Okay. Sounds great.
Okay.
Too much to learn.
everyone. Welcome to Monday of week 6. Hope you're ready to go. I am excited to be here with you. First, I want to say that I did get to check out this film after it opened last Tuesday, and I found it to be quite compelling. It's pretty darn cool, and I once again encourage you to watch it. The themes throughout the movie overlap those of BiSci pretty tightly in a lot of different ways, and so I encourage you to take in this film if you have the chance. It's on Netflix, free. Yep, available. Check it out. I want to shout out to all of you for taking adventures, maybe taking some risks, finding some new ways to celebrate being outdoors yesterday for the virtual and real life field trip. So I just loved some of these photos from your lab groups. So I just want to shout out to you for really doing it and having some adventures outside. Here's one more. Penn State map. Love it. Way to go. A new blog prompt is up. So remember that you can find the blog through Canvas. You go to Canvas and then Pages, and the blog is listed there. And here's the new topic that's listed there. Title is Separation. You click on the header there, and this is what pops up. Andy Goldsworthy said, "We often forget that we are nature. Nature is not something separate from us. So when we say that we have lost our connection to nature, we've lost our connection to ourselves." So then consider Goldsworthy's words in the context of how separation shows up within your own life. Or if you feel differently than he does, express your own belief and how your belief plays out in your own life. Remember that I language is powerful. We aren't speaking for other people, just speaking for ourselves. So I encourage you, if you'd like to put an entry up in the blog for extra credit, that's available to you. I did send out an announcement today about, for those of you who were struggling with pack back last evening, it seems their shortages happen on Sunday evenings, and at least those are the ones we know about. And so I've extended the deadline for the pack back prompt to tonight at midnight for those of you who were struggling last evening. Thank you for letting me know. Thanks for letting your TAs know, and so that I could inquire about what's going on out there in the world. And so that deadline is extended until tonight at 11:59. I wanted to say that I came away from Wednesday's class feeling unsettled, and I figured out what bothered me. It's the slide with the image that has racism and sexism and homophobia crossed out, and species at the bottom, and not crossed out. Implying that, I don't want to imply that speciesism is more important than these other things, these other belief systems. And yeah, I just want to say that there's, all of these are biases that to be aware of, to open our world to, will create relationship if we are able to be aware of our own biases and how they show up in our lives, and understanding that it's these things that separate us from other relationships, and that we have the power to make choices about how to move ahead with how we create relationships. Speciesism, the idea that because non-human animals are not human, their interest in their lives matters less than our interest in our lives. And that ties right into where we're going to be today. Today's topic is insects. And we single out insects because it's tricky to sometimes create relationship with insects or to understand our relationship with insects. And yet there are billions of insects, trillions of insects on this planet. So I'd like you to take in this slide and then just get curious. Get curious about what you see. It says write down two questions. You can ignore the page 69 part. Write down two questions based on what you see. And in this case, you can put your questions into the Zoom chat. So I'd like you just to take a couple of minutes to do that. Really just take in this image of all these interesting insects. I love some of these questions that are coming in, some real curiosities. What do they all have in common? What do they share? Which one has been on Earth longest? How are we dependent on these life forms, and how are they dependent on us? Are they dangerous? Why are none of them pink? Will they bite? Will they bite me? Why do some insects serve a purpose and others don't? Or maybe they all do and I just don't know it. So this kind of curiosity is what we're going to get at today. We're going to dig into our curiosity about insects. There are still great questions coming. I love the things that you've observed about them. And so I'll say just a few basic things. They're all arthropods. Insects fall into this category of arthropods. And somebody's question here, why do we feel superior to bugs, but they scare us? It's an interesting contradiction of thought for inside of some of us. Are any of these species now extinct? So many questions. And so I don't have all those answers. They're great questions. Arthropods includes the insects and the spiders and the crustaceans. They're all related. Those horseshoe crabs that we looked at the other day, those fall into the group of arthropods as well as the crustaceans. They all have body segments, an exoskeleton. They're all cold-blooded. In fact, they're quite the opposite of us as mammals. All of those things are different than we have. Nine out of ten animals on this planet are insects. They have six legs, a thorax, and an abdomen, as well as their head, so that's a three segments in their body. And as you scan over this slide, you can often see where those three segments divide. And yet the one thing we share is that we all share this planet and the space. And so your questions are really interesting in the ways that, how do we intersect with these insects? Do we intersect with them? What do they do? So today we're going to be expanding our knowledge about insects and what they, how they do intersect our lives, or ours intersect theirs. And so we'll start with, again, that curiosity as basis for relationship. This is a Madagascar hissing cockroach, and I'd like to introduce some of your TAs that are going to introduce you to Madagascar hissing cockroaches. So let me get this video up for you to check out.
So Madagascar hissing cockroaches are one of the biggest species of cockroaches. You can differentiate the males and females. The males have protrusions on their thorax, while the females might not have any, or just smaller ones. So that one would be a male right there, and then that one would most likely be a female. And male and females usually are a little bit bigger. They might even be having babies, and they're very chill if you don't disturb them. They hiss, they have small holes, and they force air out, and that's how they hiss, they make that sound. So males will either hiss to defend or protect against predators, or and protect their territory, or when they're mating, or during courtship, or just to communicate to one another, while females will only hiss when they're disturbed. So a lot of our TAs who have had female cockroaches have experienced that, where they'll hiss at them if they're trying to pick them up and they're disturbing them. But as you can see, this little guy is very chill, just sensing where he is. He's in a new place, away from his buddies. But they have a beautiful color and are very unique insects. Looks like he's cleaning his legs.
Wow. They're actually quite beautiful. You have a lot of stereotypes of cockroaches being gross and disgusting, but they're very colorful, and they're very docile most of the time. And they're very just sweet little creatures.
Looks like it's a baby. It's a little bit younger. I grabbed tweezers because it was running really quickly. But if you look here, he's kind of holding on to the tweezers. My first year in BiSci, I didn't want to hold the cockroach.
Got it.
But now, after seeing them several times, I'm going to slowly put them on my hand. And I always ask my students when I was a TA, if you saw one of these in your apartment, would you really want to kill it? Would you squash this little guy? What's he doing to you?
Okay. So I don't know if you can tell, but I'm still afraid. Even though this is my third time doing this, but it's okay. Because they are another me, and I'm trying to remind myself of that, even though I'm sweating profusely right now. Okay, cool. Thank you. My hands are sweating. I don't know if you feel that.
I don't like that. So, there you go.
What do I? This is Stinky number 3. I named the first one I held Stinky, the second one Stinky 2, and this one Stinky 3. I have found that they're very soft, actually. Look at them. He's saying hi with his little antenna.
So if you're watching this and you're seeing us playing with the cockroach and that still get that feeling of, ugh, or that's disgusting, that's a cockroach, maybe ask yourself, is this an opportunity to unlearn, to maybe lean into that weirdness and scariness, to maybe think, how are we really that different from hissing cockroach? What can we learn from them? They're so unique. And I'm so uncomfortable. This isn't my everyday life. I don't go around picking up bugs, but they are so intelligent, beautiful, and I can learn from them and that discomfort.
Yep. I've also found that, I feel like grabbing onto me. I've also found that the general, like, I guess, stereotype of cockroaches is that they scurry a lot and that they're very quick moving. And they can be. But they kind of feed off of your energy. And I'm definitely not as calm as I'd like to be right now. But, yeah.
So, Madagascar hissing cockroaches don't dwell in human dwellings. They live on the forest ground, you know, in logs or maybe decaying plants. They really just tend to eat or live among, like, leaves and logs, and will eat kind of whatever is on the forest ground. And they live up to 5 years. So
wow.
They're pretty tenacious. Some other insects we have here are there's a tarantula here. He's just chilling. We also have a desert beetle. Just his little butt. And then we have a stick bug. And they camouflage a lot. So you can see really up close through the glass how much they actually look like a stick. And there's more in here too, but like this one is moving around. You see how well they can camouflage with the leaves.
Right?
So, that's super cool. And of course, we have our Madagascar hissing cockroaches.
Oh my god. Just have go. There's so many. And it kind of makes me think, like, why are we scared of them? You know, like, why do we love our dogs and cats so much but are so scared of these little cockroaches? What's really the difference?
So curiosity, basis for relationship. Those Madagascar hissing cockroaches are wingless and flightless. They're decomposers. They live down on the forest floor or in dead trees where they're going to be eating all kinds of organic material that falls down. They help to make that soil rich by helping to, well, they eat that stuff and then poop out the leftovers. So they are, again, native to Madagascar. And they are so different from us in so many ways, and yet also similar to us. You might remember back to that discussion last week about the bacteria that live in and on us, that we are not a single organism. That's true. We are composite. We are composite, and so are the cockroaches. Living on these cockroaches. The cockroaches are very clean animals. You notice that they were holding them with their bare hands, that the cockroaches weren't leaving all kinds of crud behind. They have a symbiotic relationship with mites that live only on them. The mites eat organic debris that collects between the cockroaches' legs that eliminates material that would foster mold growth on the insects' bodies. So we'll take, here's an up-close picture, but I want to check out, here's another video for you.
Is there anything more lowly than the lowly cockroach? Yeah, there is. that's a cockroach mite. It lives its entire life on this cockroach. But these hitchhikers are doing a lot more good than you might think. The mites are only found on one type of cockroach. These guys, Madagascar hissing cockroaches, which are known for their hiss, of course. They do that when disturbed or looking for a mate. They only live in the Madagascar rainforest on an island off the coast of Africa. And they're bigger than the cockroaches you might find in your kitchen, like these brown-banded roaches. These pests will eat anything. Food scraps, poop, trash, you name it. As a result, they can spread disease or trigger allergies. Hissing cockroaches are detritivores. They mainly eat decaying leaves, tidying up the forest floor. They can even be kept as pets because they're more docile than their common cousins. And more importantly, they're a lot cleaner, thanks to a permanent population of tiny housekeepers. Okay, yeah, it looks pretty bad. The mites crowd together in the crevices, places where the cockroach can't brush them off. They get their meals near the cockroach's head, gobbling up the food bits and saliva that the cockroach leaves behind. When they get thirsty, they head to the spiracles, the openings the roach uses to breathe. The mites get water vapor from them. The roach also has one special hissing spiracle for that signature sound. The mites live on a single roach unless they get passed on from roach parent to roach baby. They're doing these cockroaches a favor. By cleaning up the old food and debris, the mites help keep them free of mold and pathogens, potentially extending the roaches' lives. Really, both a hissing cockroach and its mites have the same important job, keeping the world a little bit neater. Not so lowly, after all.
So the mites. Interesting in this case because it's an arthropod living on an arthropod. But mites can live other places too. So if you look closely at this photo, at the bottom of those tubes, you can see there is the little brown lumps at the base of each of those tubes. Those tubes happen to be a highly magnified photo of human eyelashes. And the little lumps right at the base of each hair follicle, those are mites. They're living in your eyelashes right now. I'll show you here. Here they are. This is a magnified color photo. Obviously, they've colored it for our entertainment. They live in those the follicle bases where our eyelashes grow out. And the mites, their closest relatives are spiders and ticks. And why? Why are they in our eyelashes? What the heck are they doing there? Well, it's very similar to the mites that are living on the cockroaches. They're helping to keep our eyes healthy and clean. They might be eating the bacteria that's associated with the skin there. They might eat the dead skin cells around the base of our eyelashes. Some people think they're eating the oil from the glands around and in our skin. These female mites lay their eggs around the rim of the pore that they are living in. but they probably don't lay many because their eggs are huge. Their eggs are quite large compared to the being of the mite. They might be 1/3 to 1/2 the size of the female's body, would be very metabolically demanding. So they probably only lay one egg at a time. I guess you could think of that as a good thing. Speaking of things, the species name for these is Demodex mites. And speaking of things they need to push out of their bodies, actually, Demodex mites do not poop. They do not have anuses. And so they do not poop. They don't get rid of their waste. But of course, they do die in our eyelashes. And so that's when all of that matter then decays. These, I want to say, are on everyone's faces. It seems as though our species has carried Demodex mites for a long time, and there's even speculation that it might be, quote, since we evolved from our hominid ancestors, that we have had this relationship with Demodex mites. When they looked at the DNA of the mites, she found that mites that were collected from Chinese populations of people were distinctly different from those collected from North and South American populations. And so because of these slight differences, these genetic variations, it could be that people, now scientists can say how our ancestors migrated around the planet. And it might reveal which modern populations are most closely related. We might be able to figure out human associations that we weren't able to figure out or see before. Demodex mites and the microorganisms in our guts are with us throughout our entire lives. Our bodies are seething with those microorganisms. We are entire ecosystems. So when we consider this chart again, we can quickly understand that the cockroaches and the Demodex mites and those microorganisms are all our biological kin. We're all made of the same stuff, the same nutrients that they are. This leads to a greater understanding of biodiversity, for sure. So to continue our conversation then about insects, they are the most biodiverse scientific group on the planet. They make up about 75 to 80% of the animal species that have been named. They are the living beings that run the world. Run the world? What do I mean by that? They pollinate the plants. Without insect pollination, many food plants that we grow in our gardens or that grow wild around the world cannot complete the pollination process and therefore would not produce fruits and vegetables. All plants require pollination in order to make seeds and fruit. Many types of animals are part of that process of pollination. It might be birds or bats, and maybe even some land mammals. But the most common pollinators by far are the insects. Insect pollination is crucial to most gardens, and it's simple. The insects like bees and butterflies and wasps are flying from flower to flower to collect the nectar, the food that they need. But the pollen gets stuck on their legs, and then that pollen travels from one plant to the next. And in doing this, this fertilizes the flower, and the plant will grow the seeds, and then that's the fruit that's around the seeds. So as pollinators, insects are vital. Insects are also soil aerators. Aeration is the naturally occurring process of air exchange between the soil and the surrounding atmosphere. So when those insects are making tunnels and boring down into the soil,
It's separating the grains. It's making tunnels that allow air and also water to travel into the soil and stay healthy. Aeration reduces the soil compaction and it promotes root growth for healthier plants. So the roots need the air and they need the water as well. So insects are providing aeration and then simultaneously benefiting. They improve that soil quality through this process, but then also, like I said before, insects are pooping. So whatever they're eating, they're pooping out the nutrients. They're adding to those additional nutrients for plant growth that's so necessary. This is fertilizer. As small as it might be, this is something that can be added to the nutrient cycle. And what they eat can be a lot of different things. So for the Madagascar hissing cockroach, they're decomposing the fruits and leaves and on the forest floor. But other insects are decomposing other things, like these flies. The dead bodies of plants and animals are rich in organic matter that provide nutrition for many insects. Those insects are called saprophages, and that means to devour rotten stuff. The insects are adapted to this lifestyle because they help recycle that dead organic material. So as gross as this may seem, it's really vital to the Earth's processes that insects are doing this job. And the insects themselves, because there are so many different species, so many different numbers and kinds, their bodies, when they die, too, add that fertilizer to the ground. So the monarchs, as you know, or as you may know, are migrating right now. They're headed down to Mexico to a roost site that has not too long ago been discovered, where those monarchs overwinter. They go into a torpor, a kind of sleep where their bodies slow way down. And in some cases, they slow down so much that they don't survive, that they die there while they're in their overwintering grounds. And whether it's there in Mexico or whether it's here as the caterpillars die or butterflies or all kinds of insects, that's adding nutrients back into the soil. Their bodies go back to Earth, and with the plentitude of them, they may be small, but they hold a plentitude of nutrients. So that is how they contribute to the Earth as well. And then there are food for tons, many, many, many different species. This is a picture of a merlin. It's a raptor that feeds on, obviously, on insects and sometimes birds. They're in the falcon family, and they catch these dragonflies in flight, snag them right out of the air. And then they're able to carry them along until either they can perch like this, or sometimes I've seen them eating in flight. So they're able to hold the food with their feet, and then they bend down with their beaks, and they snack on the wing. It's kind of like to-go snacks. When you're walking around campus eating your donut or your apple, then you're having a to-go snack. And animals can do that too. So insects provide food for a lot of different beings. That food chain, the nutrient cycle, continues. They do provide food for people as well. When people eat insects, it's called entomophagy. Entomology is the study of insects. Entomophagy is the eating of insects. Sometimes it's the eggs, sometimes it's the larva, sometimes it's the pupa, sometimes it's the adult. And they've been eaten by people since prehistoric times. This isn't a new fad that's happening at high-class restaurants in LA. It is happening there, but it's not only happening there. It's been happening since the dawn of people eating insects. They're very high in protein. There are about 3,000 ethnic groups that practice entomophagy around the world today. Human insect eating is common in cultures in most parts of the world, including Central and South America, Africa, Asia, Australia, and New Zealand. 80% of the world's population or world's nations eat insects. However, in some societies, insect eating is taboo or uncommon. Here in North America, that's the case, that eating insects is uncommon. And so there are companies that are trying to introduce insect eating into our Western diets. The Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations is one of those. And they have registered 1,900 edible types of insects and estimate that in 2005, there were 2 billion people that were eating insects around the world. They are suggesting that entomophagy is a possible solution to environmental degradation caused by livestock production. So by eating lower on the food chain, we are saving a lot of those nutrients that it takes, saving a lot of the energy that it takes to grow the cattle, to grow the pigs, to grow the turkeys and the chickens. So by eating lower on the food chain, we are eating more easily on this planet. And as much as I know that this is true, I struggle with this idea of entomophagy. My boys went off to the Penn State Insect Fair a couple of years ago with a friend of mine while I had to work. And when I got back in my car the next day, there was a little container that contained trail mix. And so I opened it up. It was just a little plastic container. And I looked at what it was, and it was a trail mix that contained crickets. And I thought, well, here is my opportunity to unlearn how I feel about this. And I have to admit that I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. I'm not there. As much as I know and feel that this is wise for the planet and good for me as far as protein, I simply couldn't do it yet. Someday I will do it. But I have been conditioned to feel as though insect eating was not for me. A lot of us have been conditioned about insects in a lot of different ways. Many of us have been conditioned to not like or even hate insects based on what our role models said or did, and the beliefs of those role models. So if my mom smashed bugs in our home, then I'm more likely to smash them. But if my mom took the time to take insects out of our house when they were trapped in there, then I'm more likely to have respect for them. If my mom served me mealworms and crickets, then I'm much more likely to understand that that's the way of being. But if my mom didn't, then it's difficult to overcome sometimes the frozen beliefs, and that's what I'm working on. It's simple. It's what I know. It's what I've seen. And yet, beliefs are frozen thoughts, and we can change them. I can change my frozen thoughts. I can thaw them, so to speak. And so now, through this class, exercising this curiosity is a way to start to warm up those frozen beliefs. the more of the world that I am in relationship with, the more alive I become. We are all beings together in this community of Earth. So how can we do that? How can we exercise that curiosity? Here's this fella. He's the Dalai Lama. He's a transcendent teacher. He's the Buddhist spiritual leader of the Tibetan people. And with that said, though, he is also a role model for lots of people from lots of walks of life. They believe what he has to say because he promotes basic human values, secular ethics, in the interest of human happiness and global happiness, including all species. He fosters interreligious harmony and the preservation of culture of peace and nonviolence. And so a lot of people look to the Dalai Lama for his wisdom. And so it was one day that there was a group of people that went to see the Dalai Lama, and their question for him was, what is the most important thing for us to teach our children? And his response was, teach them to love the insects. Teach them to love the insects. Why did he say that? Why do you think his response was, teach them to love the insects? I'd like you to take 5 minutes now and talk about that in your Zoom rooms. Why did he say, teach the children to love the insects? I'm seeing some really beautiful things coming through the chat. Somebody said, because maybe if we can love something so different than us as insects, then loving other people and animals will be easy. Somebody said, insects are crucial for life and they keep us and the earth healthier. So we need to learn not to hurt them and to prevent their extinction. There's beauty in the little things, and the stigma around insects and how we fear them or crush them can be a reflection on how we see the planet. Loving insects can teach us to appreciate the small things in life and recognize the importance of other species. Somebody said, if you teach children that insects are beautiful rather than ugly, this will help them realize that society usually shapes our standards of beauty. So there are lots of reasons that the Dalai Lama could have answered this way. Really beautiful, connected things. Someone said, bugs are just there to do their jobs and go about their lives, and often we just kill them. How would we like it if someone just killed us when we were at work? Just by not knowing, by not being curious. So if you find insects that you are curious about, iNaturalist is a really good resource for you. It's an app that you can put on your phone, and now since there are billions of people with phones worldwide, iNaturalist contributes information to research projects. I'll say more about this in a future class. So it is Earth that we all have in common, and we can appreciate more of it by forming these relationships. So here's your pack back prompt for this week. The more of the world I am in relationship with, the more alive I become. Thank you very much for your time today, and I look forward to seeing you again on Wednesday. Be well.